37th Division of the Psalms. I want to pick up reading with verse 1. And I'll read down through and including verse 7. And I'm not going to be long this morning. Psalm 137. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept. When we remembered Zion, we hung our harps upon the willows in the midst of it. For there those who carried us away captive required of us a song. And those who plundered us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her skill. If I do not remember you, let my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth. If I do not exalt Jerusalem above my chief joy, remember, O Lord, against the sons of Edom, the day of Jerusalem, who said, raise it to its very foundation. Let's read those last two verses. O daughter of Babylon, who are to be destroyed, happy shall he be who repays you as you have served us. Happy shall he be who takes and dashes your little ones against the rock. May the Lord's rich blessing be to the reading of his word. May it be sanctified in our hearts. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you in the mighty name of Jesus. And as Brother Matthew has so beautifully sang to us, falling in love with Jesus is indeed the best thing that we've ever done. And in his arms, we indeed feel protected and we never feel disconnected when we're close to him. Speak a good word to your people today that might encourage them, might strengthen them, Father, might buttress them up on every side. They will know that they've not been forsaken, that you still are close to them, just a whisper prayer away. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and give thanks. Amen. I want to speak this morning from the simple subject that is not too dangerous to remember. It's not too dangerous to remember. The words of this song had gripped my heart when I was just a teenage boy. And when I read them to you, you will remember them. Memories, like the corners of my mind, misted, watered, colored memories of the way we were. Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then, or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories may be beautiful, and yet, what's too painful to remember, we simply choose to forget. Can it be that it was all so simple then, or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories may be beautiful, and yet, what's too painful to remember, we simply choose to forget. So it's the laughter we will remember whenever we remember the way we were. Amen? That's my girl Barbara Streisand, y'all. She could work with that. And that's 1973. That's the year that I graduated from high school. And so psychologists will tell us that we are marked by the music of our youth, the music that we are touched with in our early adolescent years in particular will be the music that we will sing for the rest of our lives in most cases. And so every now and then I'll be in some place. I think I was in the dentist's office a couple of weeks ago, and they had this music in the background, and I heard something come on that took me back to my teen years. It was my main man, Al Green, y'all, singing Let's Stay Together. When Al starts, couldn't nobody croon like the man from Memphis, right? And so Al was something else. And so every now and then you hear those music. And to show you how powerful music is that if you are a very very close listener and connoisseur of commercials, you'll often notice that a lot of the songs that are now being played is being played that we grew up with. Those in my age range, why? Because we got the money, right? And so we're in those spending years, those high income peak years for many of you. And so they're now trying to appeal to a different age group. As a matter of fact, for years, Toyota, one of the most conservative companies in the world. I met Mr. Toyota, as a matter of fact. He was here down in the Buffalo not too long ago. And Mr. Toyota is still running the show. He's about 100 years old or close to it. And very conservative company, right? But if you notice, for many, many years, Toyota had a commercial that says, I am everyday people. Y'all know who that was, don't you? That was one of the most militant and radical, right, singers of the 70s. That was Sly and the Family Stone, right? And Sly was always stoned whenever he gave a concert. But because of the power of that tune and the power of that music and the appeal that it has to a certain generation, the manufacturers of these products will use music because this music touches us emotionally. And what they're trying to do is to get us to make an emotional connection to their product or to their good or to their service. And so as we are in this middle of this Memorial Day weekend, it's a time that we remember. We remember things that were pleasant, pleasurable, and we remember things that were painful because we remember loved ones. And I think that we underestimate Memorial Day. I think we should take Memorial Day more seriously in terms of planning for it and building up to it the way we would do Thanksgiving or even Christmas or Easter. I think it's an important time for us to put the past in the proper context and put the people in the past in the proper context to remember and to honor them in the way that the holiday was intended to do. So Memorial Day is a time of remembrance, and we can become very sad and very melancholy. At the same time, our spirit can be lifted as we remember the frivolity and the laughter and the joy associated with memories of our past, particularly when we associate those memories with people that we love dearly. I believe that God has given us this incredible capacity in the human brain to store information, and those who know the science of the brain, they say that everything we've ever heard, everything we've seen, that is still there somewhere. But the ability to try to recall it and bring it back to the conscious memory is always the challenge. But they say the brain is that marvelous of a computer. It is more marvelous than any computer you ever could imagine. They say it's all there. And I believe that God has given us the capacity to remember places and events and people and experiences so that we can memorialize the past, we can remember the past, remember people of the past, and that we also can vicariously experience joy if we chose to. And we can learn to discipline ourselves and not allow ourselves to be continually harassed by our past, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Our most painful memories, however, can serve one or two purposes. Our most painful memories can serve one or two purposes. The first purpose our most painful memories can serve, it can serve to paralyze us. It can paralyze us and trap us in the past. We can be held hostage in the past, and the most miserable people that I've ever met in my life are individuals who are paralyzed, who are imprisoned, who are held hostage by their past, who are unable to free themselves from the past. And many times those are the individuals that are still living with either guilt, they're living with shame, with a tremendous remorse, with tremendous disappointment, or they may be living with tremendous unforgiveness. Unforgiveness. And so the memories of the past, it can hold us hostage. It can paralyze us. We can be trapped there, and we can lose the joy of the present. And we can forfeit the potential joy of the future. Memories are powerful. And that's why we need to experience the grace of God and the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. Because in experiencing forgiveness, we then have the capacity to forgive. I have the capacity to forgive because I've experienced forgiveness. So my past failures, my past defeats, my past things where I've done things that were royally wrong and incorrect, I could be paralyzed by that, but because I know that in Jesus Christ, I can experience forgiveness, salvation, and relief from that. So knowing that I have been forgiven gives me the ability to be able to forgive if I choose to ask God for that grace to do so. Will y'all help me today? I'm not going to be long. But the second thing that the memories of our past can do, they can serve as a measuring rod. The memories of our past can serve as a measuring rod to help us to measure the magnitude of the grace of God in our lives. We can look back at our life and where we were and what we've done in the past and what we've been through and what we've endured in the past, and we can see that God has brought us a mighty long way, and it's those memories that help us to keep things in a context that says that God is a big God, He is a great God, God can do big things because I can see where God has done some big things in my life. Oh, the voice, the memory of Elise Watts. Elise Watkins in my head this morning because I can remember one of her favorite songs. She used to like to sing, Sister Belinda, in the Sunday school class. Count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. So the memories of our past, as we chronicle and as we document the things that's happened to us, things that we've been through, things that we have endured, our memories can serve as a measuring rod to help us to realize God is indeed with me. God has been with me, and I didn't know it. Surely God was in some of those dark places. They didn't take me out, and I didn't know that God was there. So I know something of God's power and grace in my life. Amen. Memories are important. And the past is important. Not to celebrate great victories of the past because we can't live in the past. And that's the problem with some athletes today. They still living on a past reputation, Judge Tinsley. On a past reputation, right? On a past reputation. I'm going to tell y'all a secret. I've only told this to a few people. I stopped playing competitive basketball, right, when I was about 27 or 28. Right at the peak of my game. Made one cameo return appearance and when I was age 30. I'm the same age as Sugar Ray Leonard. So Sugar Ray came out of retirement at age 30 to fight Tommy Herron. So I came out of retirement at 30 to see if I could still win the Union Carbide Basketball Championship. Right. So after Sugar Ray and I came out and did our thing at age 30, I hung up the sneaker, stopped playing. And people say, I can't believe that all those years you played and how much you love sports and how much you love. Let me tell you why I did it, Brother Jimmy. I wanted people to remember me at my best. I wanted to remember me at my best when I would come down the court, stop at about 25 feet out, shoot the basket, turn around and say layup before the ball hit the rim. No one's going to be nothing but that. I want them to remember that type of athletic arrogance, not in my best. I don't want these young whippersnappers coming up, you know, breaking my ankles and causing me to fall and get no reputation on me. I don't want them to come and slap. Oh, no, I want them to remember at the height of my power, at the height of my glory. So I walked away from it all, didn't play no more, wouldn't even go know where anybody was playing. Somebody else did that. Archie Talley. Archie Talley walked away from Archie walk around watching people play, and sometimes he and I would be somewhere together watching other people play, and we would say, they ain't going to get no reputation on us. We left at the top of our game, we left, walked away from it, so that people could remember us a certain way. And I'm often amazed when people talk about me playing basketball, they make me much better than what I was, see? So I like that. I like the fact they remember something I didn't even do. They remember a statue that I never even had, but it makes me feel good. And I realize my plan worked. It worked. Because they remember me at my very best. And not me trying to get up the court with ace bandages on and smelling like leather mitt, you know, knee braces. No, I ain't want to be remembered like no broken down athlete. I want to be remembered at my best. And if you want to watch something powerful, this is just a commercial. I just happened to be surfing the channels and saw it. LeBron James, this boy, they have come up with a masterpiece. They did a 3-hour series on Muhammad Ali. And he's doing all the talking. They went and found all of this video footage of Muhammad Ali, all these interviews, and they put together this documentary about him. And it's entitled, What's My Name? It is powerful. And you see his whole career from the beginning all the way to the end. But unfortunately, you also see the amazing decline. The amazing decline right there on the screen over this 3-hour period of time at what happened to him and what that sport did to him and what he ended up was in the end, right? After he finished, it's worth watching. It's worth some of you young people watching. It's a history lesson, actually, of what was taking place in the 60s and his relationship with Malcolm X. It's all there in one package, and they do it on 2.5-hour special that's currently being showed, The Memories of the Past. Let me look at this text and let you guys get to your dinner for this afternoon. This text is about people remembering. Psalm 137. It's after the Babylonian captivity, somewhere between 586 B.C. and 538 B.C. In 586, the Babylonians that came in from the north and they had invaded Israel and they just kind of wreaked havoc, basically, leveled Jerusalem. And that's when Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and those fellows were taken back to be prisoners in Babylon. And they so crippled the land that they just left the old people back and the infirm and the handicapped, and that's who they left in Jerusalem. But the Babylonians made one mistake. They left one old, broken-down prophet in Jerusalem, a man by the name of Jeremiah. They shouldn't have done that because Jeremiah prophesied during the exile, and he prophesied to the people, God hadn't forgotten you. He still have a future for you, and he sent his letter to the people in Babylon, and they were encouraged by the fact that even though we rejected God, we backslid away from God, we went whoring after false gods, one day God is going to remember us, and God is going to take us back to the land. And Jeremiah gave them a time frame. It's going to be about 70 years. So some of you adults, you're going to die as exiles in Babylon. You're going to have children, but your children, your seed, God is going to remember them. He's going to bring them back into the land. So this text opens up, they're still in the land or toward the end of the captivity. It opens up by saying, by the rivers of Babylon there we sat down, yea, we wept, and we remember Zion. By the rivers of Babylon, now they're in the captivity and they realize we have made a royal mess out of this situation. A once proud people, an independent people, an enterprising people with a robust economy, with all the grandeur of Jerusalem and of the temple worship, all of that activity, now they realize we have forfeited all of it, and now we are vagabond slaves in a foreign land among a pagan people, and they sat down beside the Babylon River and they just wept. They wept over what they had forfeited. They wept over what they had lost, and they knew they had nobody to blame except for themselves. So they are now remembering in great sorrow, remembering great sorrow that they're in this situation of exile, and they're there because of their own choices and their own decisions. In our lives, we can find ourselves sometime in spiritual exile, lonely, discouraged, even depressed, knowing that we made some bad decisions and some bad choices. And no matter how we try to blame somebody else, when we look in the mirror, we know it's the man or woman that's in the mirror that's most responsible for the predicament we find ourselves in, and that's where the children of Israel were. The psalmist sobs with great pathos, great passion, as he describes the heartbreak and the pain of the captivity. This once proud, this noble, this independent people have now been reduced to nothing but beasts of burdens, slaves among a pagan people. He knew that they were responsible for it. Just the thought of remembering Zion, just to remember Zion. You know, I went back home this week, and I always feel better after I go back home. Judge Tinsley, I go back up on the mountain, I breathe that fresh air. I went back to my little hometown where I was born and raised, Mount Hope, West Virginia, Brother Greg, and I just stood up on the top of the mountain, beat my chest like I was King Kong. So this used to be my domain. This used to be where I ruled, the little sandlot football and basketball and track and things that we did that just was wonderful to be back home. And some of the old heads were back in. They were actually peers of my brother, who's my 9-year senior, and they created this organization, the Mount of Hope organization, and they wanted to honor my brother. Imagine, he'd been dead for 53 years, and they still remember him. I'm amazed by that. 53 years after he died, tragically in a car accident at the age of 17, his friends still remember him, and tears swell up in their eyes every time they talk about him. He was our Sir Lancelot. He was our beautiful black prince, integrated to Mount Hope Little League Baseball program, and was such a gifted athlete, they called him, after the Chicago Bulls, Chicago White Sox shortstop Ernie Banks. That's what they called. He was that bad, bad boy. 17, 16 years old, went to Washington, D.C., and tried out for the Washington Senators, and they said, boy, just go back and graduate from high school, and we got a contract for you. And they remember him, and it makes me feel good that he has not been forgotten by Mickey Plumlee and by Baby Charles McKinney and by Phil Tissue and Jack Spadaro and all these guys who grew up in that little town. They still remember him. And so they put me to serve on this board, this organization, in his place, that he never will be forgotten. His legacy will always be remembered. There's something about memories, y'all. And as I think about it, I actually miss it. It's 54 years. My brother died on May the 30th, 1965. It'll be 54. It actually happened on Memorial Day, 54 years ago. And I always go through this thing of remembering him. And so it's amazing. We went back to this little neighborhood, and they're talking about Sister Belinda, the graveyard, the Mount Hope graveyard, the cemetery that's overran with weeds and so forth. And you know what they're talking about doing? They said, we got to volunteer to clean the graveyard off because we got to find Ricky's grave. I sit there, and I wept. I couldn't believe they were talking about him like that. I said, I know where it is. I can take you right to it. I know exactly where it is. I can right beside my grandmother, right there on the side of that mountain as you exit outside of Mount Hope, West Virginia. So memories are powerful things. Even when you remember the pain, you also can remember the joy of knowing that God didn't leave us, the joy of knowing that God was with us. And I've shared this now on many of occasions. I thought I was having a nervous breakdown when I was 9 years old. I felt forsaken by the whole world, didn't want to talk to people when my brother got killed. And I look back at it now and say, God was with me and I didn't even know it. He sent people around me to encourage me, the drunks on the street. The drunks on the street of Mount Hope, West Virginia, became my source of encouragement. Read about my athletic exploits. Every time they would see me, they would encourage me, would tell me, we won't see you standing around the pool room. You ain't got no business around the pool room. We better not see you doing this or doing. I'm talking about the drunks on the street, Brother Greg. Chevrolet, you know who Chevrolet was. Hollywood, Melvin Knight, they were the biggest drunks in the town. They became my source of encouragement as a young boy. I got two witnesses, but they know exactly what I'm talking about. And that's what the people in our little community, they did for us. They didn't want our lives to be ruined or destroyed. The last thing that a drunk in Mount Hope, West Virginia would do would be to give alcohol or cigarettes to a minor. That's the last thing they would do. That would be considered a betrayal of the sacred trust of the neighborhood and of the community. And that's what I remember. So it breaks my heart when I go back to my little hometown and I see these young people. They just got this blank look on their faces. Drugs have just ruined and ravaged the little neighborhood. We have the highest percentage of children in the state of West Virginia not living with their biological parents because the biological parents then destroyed themselves with drugs and with alcohol and other things like that. And so when I go back and I walk those streets and I hum this little song, oh, it's painful to remember, but I think I'm going to remember anyhow. Because it didn't used to be like this. And maybe God will rend the heavens and God will come down. And maybe God will change. And maybe in my time, I'll see revival come back to that little neighborhood, that little community who meant so much to me. So they're by the rivers of the Babylon. Hearts are broken. They're busted. They're disgusted. They feel guilt and they feel shame. In the midst of their guilt and shame, in the midst of their brokenness, they said, we can't even sing. And they took their harps, Mother Tolliver, and they retired their harps, and they hung their harps on the willow trees, the weeping willows that surrounded the Babylon. They said, we can't even sing there. We can't even play music down here because our hearts are so heavy. Verse 3, for there those who carried us away, our captives required of us a song. And those who plundered us required us mirth, saying, sing us one of those songs of Zion. Entertain us. Recreate us. Y'all like to sing. Y'all like to dance. Y'all like to shout. Where's your shout now? Where's your dance now? Sing us one of those old hymns you used to sing down in Jerusalem. And they said, we can't sing. How should we sing the Lord's song? We're not entertainers. We're not a minstrel show. I'm a little bit concerned about the church. I'm sort of rethinking this thing. I'm talking about the church politic. Maybe we weren't supposed to be trying to entertain the world. And maybe we're taking the edge out of the gospel, the sting out of the gospel that says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and we want everybody to feel good and be uplifted but not deal with the conviction of their sin. And maybe the church needs to stop trying to entertain the world. That's what the Jews said. Now, we're not going to entertain y'all. We're not some minstrel show. We're not going to fire up the box to make y'all feel good because our hearts are heavy and our hearts are broken. Look at what the psalmist says. Verse 4, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? And then he says, if I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her skill. I ain't never heard no piano player say, may I not be able to play the piano no more. May I not be able to play the guitar no more. But what they say, if we forget Jerusalem, if we forget Zion, if we forget where the temple is, our place of worship, if we forget the city up on the hill that's at the heart of God, if we forget our spiritual roots, may God take our natural ability away from us and may we not be able to play. May our hands develop arthritis and we not be able to entertain. If it's not true worship, if it's not true worship, lifting up and exalting the name of God, may we not even be to play. We're not playing as entertainers. We're playing as those who are promoting and prompting the heart of others to worship. Are you listening to what he's saying? Let my right hand forget her skill. If I do not remember you, let my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth. If I do not exalt Jerusalem above my chief joy. May I be unable to sing. May I be unable to speak, unable to testify, if it's not for the glory of God, if it's not to exalt God's city and to exalt God's work. So you can see three times here the psalmist talks about remembering. We remember Zion, verse 1. If I do not remember you, O Jerusalem, may my tongue cling to my mouth. Verse 6, it's painful to remember, but it's important that we remember. Because remembering reminds us where God has delivered us from. What God has done for us. What God has done in our families. How God has saved members of our family to create a righteous seed. How God has protected. God has done great things. And we got to remember so we can give God the glory for it. Well, let me close. I promise I wouldn't be long. We remembered Zion. We remembered Jerusalem. And we remembered God. Verse 7. Remember, O Lord, against the sons of Edom, the day of Jerusalem, who said, raise it, to its very foundation. And what they were saying, Lord, you're going to remember. You're going to remember those that invaded our land. You're going to remember those that leveled our city. You're going to remember those who tore down the temple. You remember those that looted the temple and went inside of the temple and defiled it and took the gold and took the silver and took all of the ornaments that was a part of the worship of God and took it back to Babylon and made a part of their sadistic, polytheistic, pagan worship experience. You read in the book of Daniel, in Daniel chapter 5, and Belshazzar had a ball, and he went back in the treasury, and he brought out all of these cups and goblets and all these utensils that was used to worship God in Jerusalem. And he brought it out and he made it a part of his drunken orgy, his drunken feast, this drunken debauchery, as he was exalting himself as being some type of a god. Oh, come here, Belshazzar. And all of a sudden, the Bible said, in the midst of the ball, in the midst of his big party, in the midst of Belshazzar's drunken orgy, there was a handwriting on the wall. And some words written on the wall say, meanie, meanie, tickle your farces. And they had no idea what it meant. Nobody in Babylon, all of the scholars, all of the brilliant people, all of the intelligentsia, all of his priests, nobody could interpret what the words meant. And they went and bought a young slave boy by the name of Daniel, and they brought him in. And they said, what in the world does that mean? And Daniel said, well, it's pretty simple. Meanie, meanie, tickle your faucet. Weighed, weighed, divided. You have been weighed by God tonight in the balances. And judgment is coming. It's not coming tomorrow. It's not coming next week. It's not coming next year. Judgment is coming tonight. And in the midst of the drunken orgy in the ball, the Medes and the Persians were right across the river. And they came in and they toppled the kingdom of Belshazzar and the Babylonians, and they ushered in the Medo-Persian Empire. And Daniel was there to testify, God didn't forget us. God didn't forget us. And God brought in a whole new regime, a whole new kingdom of the Medes and the Persians to set the stage so that when the 70 years were up, there'll be a king whose heart will be tended toward the Jews and let them go home. Y'all know to read the Bible, y'all. And let them go back home. As God had prophesied, he was going to bring them back home through the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah. It's hard to remember. Sometimes it's painful to remember, but it can be cathartic. It can be healing. We remember how bad we were. Every now and then I remember how bad I was. Oh, yeah, I remember how bad I was, so I can really appreciate the grace of God, the mercy of God, and the forgiveness of God, to know that God saved me from something and saved me to something so he could use me to do something. Oh, give the Lord some praise today. And so during this Memorial Day weekend, sit down and remember. Remember the people that nurtured you. Remember the people that sacrificed for you. The people that built into your life. The people who believed in you when maybe at times you didn't believe in yourself. Remember them. Remember and reflect on the fact that their sacrificing wasn't in vain, Sister Chana. You know, I've collected a bunch of stuff like drive my wife crazy, but I'm starting to move it out and find a place to put it now. There's a couple of articles I have that's very, well, all my junk is important to me. It's not important to her. But your junk is important to you. It wouldn't be important to me. Everybody got some junk that's important to them. There's a couple of things I've collected and kept. One of them is an old saw. It's rusty. It's a little hand saw. Old saw. And my wife couldn't realize, why are you keeping an old saw? Why are you keeping an old saw? I never told her. That's my daddy's saw. My daddy's hand was on that saw. And I remember seeing him sawing two befores and doing little things. And my daddy was a philosopher. He could do just about anything. And he'd be talking junk all the time. And he talking and he building. And he said, a carpenter I'm not, but a tack I'll drive. And so he's bragging, I'm not a carpenter, never trained to be a carpenter, I can outbuild all these guys. A carpenter I'm not, but a tack I'll drive. So my daddy's hand, his hand was on that saw. I was at home in Mount Hope 5 or 6 years ago, and I was trying to find something. Used to be the department store, Age Department Store, at the end of town. Now it's an antique shop. And I think some of the antiques is the same stuff they had in the store years ago trying to sell. That's a real bona fide antique shop. So I was trying to find something, just something that would be different, just really different that I could give my wife, you know, just something different. And I came across this, some little desk, little writing table. It's really nice. And at first she didn't like it. Now it's prominent in the living room, right? But first she didn't, but it's really pretty. It's really pretty. It's real nice. But I found something else. And it caught my eye. Because it looked like exactly what I used to see my grandmama with. And you know what it is? And I bought it. I paid $25 for it. A washboard. It looked exactly like the washboard that my grandmama used to use. And I could see her in that old tub with that washboard with my dirty white underclothes. Now, there wasn't no colored underclothes back then. Everything was white. And so my grandmother, she was a stickler for cleanliness. So what would she do? She would take these clothes and this washboard, right? And she'd put the soap pile and stuff in there and the water and so forth. And then she would scrub them on this washboard. Scrub my underclothes on this washboard to try to get the grit and the grime and all that stuff out of them underclothes, which was going to be under my clothes. But it was something about her. They were under my clothes, but it was next to my body, so she wanted them to be clean. And I would say, well, Gramps, why are you doing that? She said, well, you might fall out somewhere. I said, what if I fall out, right? If I fall out, they take me to the hospital, and if I got on dirty underclothes, so what? But she thought it'd be a reflection on her if I fell out somewhere and they undressed me at the hospital and I had dirty underclothes on, so she wanted the underclothes to be clean. So I can see her, Brother Rick, scrubbing, and I knew she had arthritis in both of her hands. Scrubbing on that washboard to get them clothes white and clean. And then once she finished scrubbing them, Sister Chandler, she would put them in this big pot and put them on the stove and boil them. Do y'all know what I'm talking about? And then after she did all of that, she would take them little old arthritic hands and she would wring them out because they had that old raggedy wash machine. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Them things never did work. The wringer part never did work. It always would get stuck and get jammed up. You couldn't wring no stuff against that thing. It looked like two rolling pins next to each other. You put the clothes in it. You're supposed to smash the water out of it. It always got stuck. It never did work. So she's wringing out these clothes. And then she'd take her 4'10" self outside and sub below weather and hang them on the line. And then once they got good and froze out there, and I guess some of the water evaporated, she would bring them in the house and their clothesline strung all through the house. And then she's going to hang them up in the house and dry them out. Just so that I could have clean underclothes to come under my clothes, just in case I fell out somewhere and they had to take me to the hospital and they undressed me, I would have clean underclothes on. Amen. Are y'all with me? Now I'm gonna close, and this is the truth. God is my witness. And I tell y'all, the times I hear my grandmother's voice in my ear, it's as clear as anything. When I got sick on August the 4th, early in the morning, I woke up, had a little pain in my chest. This unusually, so I got up. And you know what I decided I needed to do? I got to take a shower. The spirit of my grandmother got up inside of me. I got up. I had to take a shower first. I showered off real good, dried off, put my dirt on, put my talcum powder on and so forth, put on some clean underclothes, put my pajamas on, and got back into bed. And then I just was in the half dream room, as Muhammad Ali would call it, between sleep and non-sleep, and just about dozed off, and the pain hit again. So I'm getting up out of it. So I got up. I packed me a little bag of clean underclothes, clean pajamas, just in case I thought they might have to keep me. Then I woke my wife up, and I told her what to tell the people, to tell them y'all need to come and take me in the wagon. I don't want you driving me. You might run over the river or something. You get nervous. Let the people come and take me in. It's the truth. So they take me into the hospital, lay me over in the corner for 2 hours, tell me nothing was wrong with me, and finally I tell my wife, you call Dr. Stanton. Somebody got to find what's wrong with me. So Dr. Stanton came, and he said, y'all get him undressed. So they brought the nurse in. This is the truth. God is my witness. They started to undress me, and the nurse and the lady, they said, you sure smell good. And I said to myself, my grandma will be happy. I'm in the hospital, I'm laying up on the bed. I got clean underclothes on, they white, and I smell good. Y'all hear me? I wash my own clothes because my wife don't like Clorox. I wash my own clothes. I wash all my underclothes. It's white. They got to be in Clorox. I put them in a heavy-duty cycle on the wash machine because my grandmama, I don't want her coming back and haunting me at night and telling me, what are you doing with dingy underclothes on for? Anyway, I almost laughed at myself when that woman said, you sure don't smell good. And I said to my grandma, Grandma, you'll be proud of me. I didn't embarrass you. I didn't embarrass you. I didn't forget what you told me. It was important. They always had clean underclothes on. If I fell out somewhere, I want to be clean and take me to the hospital. And it was ugly. The woman said, you know, a lot of people aren't. That's powerful prayer, shall we? I'm getting silly up here. Father, we're so grateful. Another glorious day you blessed us to see. We thank you, Lord, for the ability to remember even painful situations, Lord. Help us to gauge your grace, your comfort, and your mercy in our lives. And joyful situations, Lord, also help us to see the good hand of God upon us in the past. Bless your people today. Encourage them today. Strengthen them today. And during this Memorial Day weekend, as they remember family members that's gone on to be with the Lord, their hearts may be a little bit heavy, but may they also remember the laughter, the joy, the frivolity, the excitement, the celebration that they had together. And may those memories, Lord, bring them great comfort and encouragement. In Jesus' name, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. As you remember this morning the good hand of God upon your life, recommit your life to him to serve him the remaining days of your life. Ask for a fresh anointing upon your life to help you. If you never come to faith in living Christ today, maybe today, give the Lord a chance. If you want to be saved, just ask the Lord to come to your heart and to save you today, to forgive you today. He'll do it. Is there one here today?
Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind.
Now was the day, the day of salvation.
Smiles we gave to one another for the way we were.
As you remember your loved ones today, thank the Lord for them. Thank God for what they meant to you.
Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me.
Yes, Lord. We're in the midst, Lord. God, we thank you for this great message today, God. We thank you, God, for the memories, God, Lord. Lord, right now, God, we let us cast our cares upon you, God, because you care for us, Lord. Right now, we're praying for Brother Matthew right now,
yes, Lord.
Lord, just that it be for him to be encouraged, Lord. God created in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us, God. God, right now, God, that whatever's going through his mind,
yes, Lord,
whatever, God, just healing, God.
Give him
God,
victory,
we know that
Lord.
You're a healer, God.
Give him victory.
We know that you have strength, Lord.
Yes,
God,
Lord.
Just give him strength, Lord. The joy of the Lord
yes.
is our strength, God.
Yes, Lord.
God, we thank you, God, through our family, through the church, through everyone, God, to encourage this young man and everyone to encourage, Lord. God, we praise you and we honor
yes,
you today, God.
Yes,
Lord, we love you, God. We thank you for dying on the cross and raising
yes,
on the third day, Lord. We thank you for your mercy and your grace, Lord. We thank you, God, because you forgave us, God.
Yes, Lord.
And God, just let us, God, within ourselves, God, forgive ourselves, Lord. God, of whatever. done, Lord. God, we praise you and we honor you, Lord.
Yes,
and we thank you for this day, God. Mm-hmm. And be encouraged,
yes.
Lord. God, as David had to go back,
yes,
and encourage himself, God.
Yes.
Let us encourage ourselves. And
yes,
let us go with the brothers and the sisters,
yes,
and everyone, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, encourage one another, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name, yes, I just want to pray. Be encouraged,
yes,
in Jesus' name.
Amen. Bless you. Be encouraged. We pray for you, Lord.
Thank you, God.
Appreciate you. The church, amen?
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Let's prepare for our benediction, shall we? I have been reminded on three occasions that we're celebrating the May birthdays. How many May birthdays do we have? Sister Lewis, Sister Shauna, anybody else? Someone else? May? All right, Sister Shauna, all the cake is yours. Who? Oh, I didn't see the hand. Who is it? Oh, I'm sorry. Mother Tolliver, you're going to double up on us here. Mother Tolliver's birthday, Sister Shauna, so they have a little refreshments over here. And, of course, we're celebrating Brother Demisio's graduation. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Let's bow for our benediction, shall we? Father, we thank you again. Another glorious day. Great worship experience. Thank you for the fellowship. Thank you for the saints. Encourage them.